In 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Well, we tried.
The entertainment business is under attack from piracy. Millions of its customers are getting music and films for free over the internet.
The threat to the industry is enormous. It's potentially crippling. The music industry is losing billions, and the film industry is not far behind.
What the internet pirates are doing is illegal, but they believe it's harmless sharing by music and film lovers.
This is an unstoppable force, and it is the future.
The entertainment industries are fighting back, using NetPolice to track down the culprits and pushing for new laws to stop computers playing stolen material. They say the futures of the music and film industries are at stake. So who will win the battle of the cyber pirates? In ordinary suburban streets across Britain, there are some people who can see the very latest films months before the rest of us.
Good luck, Harry Potter.
They get them delivered straight to their front rooms, and what's more, it's free. The reason? They're illegally copying them off the internet.
Nielsen, symbol cryptography.
Almost everything is available to these cyber pirates, including the latest Hollywood blockbusters, like Spider-Man and Star Wars.
Well, it's tense since we fell into that nest of gun dogs. You fell into that nightmare, Master, and I rescued you, remember?
Well, I've downloaded about maybe 30 or 40 films, and I've saved about two-thirds of those so I can watch them any future time that I wanted to. In a typical week, I'll download maybe two or three films, but the number of, obviously that varies on what's out there. If there's something good, I'll try and get it. Some of the recent films that I've downloaded are Legally Blonde, Miss Congeniality, Spider-Man, Black Hawk Down.
As soon as a film premieres, pirates go into the cinema with a concealed camera, video the film, and put the results on the internet. The quality isn't important. It's getting them first that matters.
This has just been done by ordinary people who are sharing files because they're interested in making films available to other people or sharing films with other people, and in return, looking for people to share films and pieces of music with them.
Every time this internet pirate downloads a film, he's breaking the copyright law. The penalty? Up to 2 years in prison.
Are you stealing?
I don't think I'm stealing. I don't regard it as stealing, certainly not. I mean, I'm not taking something from them. They still have what they have. It's murder on the
dance floor. Hollywood, California. Behind the razzmatazz, there's deep unease in the industry about internet piracy. They're worried that jobs are at stake in both the film and music worlds.
The threat to the industry is enormous. It's potentially crippling. The music industry is losing billions, and the film industry is not far behind. Internet piracy is theft. It's pure and simple. It is theft. It's as much theft as it would be to walk into a Blockbuster and take a video and put it into your coat and walk out without paying.
The music industry estimates 6 billion copyrighted tracks are downloaded every month. The heart is a blue. At any time, up to 10 million people are illegally downloading. The global corporations that dominate the music industry say it's out of control. Universal is the biggest of all.
We're fortunate in being the largest and most successful record company in the world. We have a fantastic roster of artists. Picking on some household names, Shania Twain, U2, Elton John, Bon Jovi, Eminem.
Universal is the world's largest music company. They own record labels like Polydor, Island, Mercury, Motown, and Decca. Universal, with a turnover of £4.2 billion, has a lot to lose.
sales are falling quite dramatically. And if one used an overall figure of saying they were going down 10% year on year, then that wouldn't be a bad statistic.
The industry's troubles started in 1999 when a new service appeared on the internet. It was the creation of 19-year-old Sean Fanning, who wanted to swap his CD collection with his friends. The result was a computer program he called Napster.
I started it, you know, just because I thought it was exciting. It was just sort of a small project. It doesn't seem like a job to me. It's just fun stuff.
It was a record industry nightmare. What started out for friends soon caught on and was being used by millions. Napster allowed people to download onto their computers whatever music they fancied, at near CD quality, and absolutely for free.
Napster, which was really at the vanguard of all this, developed a business which was basically on taking music without permission, and whenever a record company spoke out about it, they were considered dinosaurs. Napster was so obviously wrong that we should have been able to get it closed down overnight.
In 2000, the music industry took Napster to court. Joining them were heavy metal giants Metallica, one of the first bands to complain about internet piracy.
If you have the right to download my music for free, then let's say that you're a plumber or you're a car mechanic or whatever, then I have the right to call you up at any time and demand that you come over and fix my plumbing for free.
Metallica hired internet detectives NetPD to prove that their records were being stolen.
Metallica took a huge petition and a huge wad of files, evidenced files, of particular downloads to the court and said, these have been downloaded, we know it, and we used our technology to prove that. We know they've been downloaded, this needs to be sorted out. And that was one of the reasons why Napster couldn't actually say that they weren't allowing copyright infringements.
It's a slow news day.
The music industry was grateful for the support, but it proved a PR disaster for the band.
If you look at Metallica, they came out and they were vociferous about what damage they thought Napster was doing to themselves. In fact, they got a backlash from it, but they were very brave about it.
Websites sprung up like MetallicaSucks.com, criticizing them for being greedy. At the same time, other artists were coming out in support of Napster.
Never question what I am, God knows. Cause it's coming from the heart. What I got, better get some.
Rap stars Public Enemy spoke in favor of the internet and used it to expand their fan base.
What the rhyme keep feeling, respect for giving, how's your living? Now I can't protect, I paid off feedback. Check the record and record.
Chuck D is the lead artist.
We got involved with putting our music on the internet in 1998. As an artist, I have to make adjustments. And I have to make adaptations. You know, when they say that it's bad for music, the record companies, it sounds like a whole bunch of lawyers and accountants that don't know music talking a lot of hogwash anyway. The problem is that if you said note to many of these people at the record company, they wouldn't know what a note is. They think a note is a banknote.
Respect's been given. How's your living? Now I can't protect.
In 2000, the music industry eventually won its court battle, and Napster was stopped.
It had no business model to attach to it. It was a free-for-all. And Napster was attacked by these big corporations with the aid of the U.S. government. Big business was crying and was knocked to its knees. I thought it was a beautiful thing.
Soon, sites modeled on Napster were springing up all over the web, and the industry found it impossible to stop them. Now, music swapping has grown and developed its own culture. Glasgow's a typical example. Donna Swaby is an internet pirate, but sees little harm in it. Despite its illegality, she doesn't mind discussing it openly.
I work as a speech therapist Monday to Friday, 9 till 4:30. Hold down a responsible job, got a mortgage, that kind of thing. But my tastes in music are probably a wee bit more unusual than other people's. So lead a fairly respectable, normal life. love music and just get music however I can.
Donna spends a couple of hours a day looking for new music. She currently has a library of 200 tracks she's downloaded onto her computer.
One of the sites that I use will have everything from classical music to abstract experimental music and everything in between, pop, rock, jazz, a lot. Pretty much if you want something, you can find it somehow.
Donna doesn't feel she's stealing or that she should be criminalised for it. She currently spends £100 a month on music.
OK, so I'm downloading music for free, but in my experience, I'm spending more money on music than I ever have. So that's why I don't have a problem with it, because I go out and I spend more money than I've ever done on records.
Optimo, in central Glasgow, is one of Donna's favourite clubs. She meets friends there who also regularly download music from the internet. Even the club itself plays music downloaded from the internet.
It's full of people that love their music, love to dance, and they're open to listen to anything. There's such a wide variety of music played there, and the DJs, Keith and Johnny, are very skillful at putting that together.
Johnny and his business partner Keith could be described as internet pirates. A lot of the music they play in the club is pre-mixed and manipulated in their studio. Although they buy many records, Johnny and Keith also use music they've downloaded from the internet in the mix.
It's a download of a Kylie Minogue, was a big, huge hit in this country. Just took it, removed her vocal, and thought, well, I'm trying to make another vocal work with it. Time stretched to put two together. There's another breakbeat of mine in there as well, which I just wrote on a drum machine. There's a breakbeat sampled off a record, so there's three or four things going on.
At Optimo, we play all sorts of music, the idea being that we will take anything that we can consider danceable and maybe co-opt that into what we do. It's like a collage in the way that an artist, a photographer, whatever, would use various source material. But we're only using this to play in the club. We're not making any money out of it. It's not being released as a record. It's for our own consumption only. I think a lot of people regard downloading music as just like theft, but if you're using it in a creative manner, I think it's a lot more than that.
The industry believes that internet piracy threatens their ability to invest in new music. The independent record producer who got Kylie's career started and produced 21 UK number one hits is Pete Waterman.
I'm trying to protect the next generation of British music, because whether it's Steps or whether it's the Beatles, somebody has to protect it, because it won't be there if it's not protected. Potentially, we are talking about maybe 50,000 job losses in the UK. If this was British Steel, people would be up in arms. These techno nerds, let's call them that, I mean, they spend hours looking for the most obscure thing, pinching bits of this, pinching bits of that. It's stealing. You can't steal off anybody just because they're rich. It's not right. You know, that's Robin Hood. And you ain't Robin Hood, mate, sitting in your bedroom.
Back in Glasgow, they don't feel that they are taking money away from the music industry.
I don't think we are denying the artists an income. I'm an artist myself. I have a band who has had records out. I'm totally happy for my music to be available on the internet because I think it's a great promotional tool. I don't think what I'm doing is piracy, because I'm not doing this for financial gain.
I'd be interested to know how these people would feel. Presumably they're fans of artists. How do they feel about taking music from artists? And what would happen if one of them decided to help themselves to the new Eminem album, and the following day Eminem came round to see them, welcomed them, had a cup of tea with them, and then picked up their computer and walked out with their computer at the end of the meeting? Would they think that's fair? In a sense, it's an exaggeration of a point, but they're taking Eminem's music, and if he came round, or any other artist came round and helped himself to their property, why would they be surprised?
But the industry's problems are growing, with new file-sharing networks offering even better technology starting all the time. One company, Xolox, started 5 weeks ago and already has 500,000 users. They think the music bosses should seize on the opportunities of the new technology.
What they could do, for instance, is use the file sharing networks as a means of promotion for their music. For instance, the Eminem CD, it came out, or it was available on file sharing networks before it was in the shops, and the record labels, they had to speed up the launch of the album, and it was a huge success because everybody had already listened to a few songs and they thought it was so cool, so everybody wants to have it. And then people purchased it, and it blew all sales records.
There is a school of thought that people who consume music for free are only tasting the music before buying it. I really don't believe that. It's not my experience from talking to consumers. It's not my experience from what's happening in the marketplace. And whilst opinion polls suggest that it's true, I simply don't believe opinion polls.
As well as the Eminem album, tracks from the latest Oasis album were available to be downloaded on the internet 3 months before it was released in the shops. The record industry says internet piracy contributed to a 10% drop in CD sales in the US last year. In 2000, 6 albums sold over 5 million copies. This year, none have. Worried by the slump, the record industry is now going after the cyber pirates themselves. They've turned to internet detectives NetPD.
Our job is to find, initially, identify and remove copyright material from the internet.
NetPD writes software that scours the internet 24 hours a day to track down illegally downloaded copyrighted music. They can even identify particular albums for artists.
There isn't a subset of artists that feel strongly about it and others that don't. It's quite a broad section. Everything from sort of golden oldies, the Paul Simons of the world, through to the George Michaels of the world. And these guys feel very strongly that their music shouldn't be downloaded for free.
NetPD's computers automatically generate emails to the internet service providers every time they find the digital downloads. The first thing the cyber pirate knows is when they're emailed by their internet service provider. You are breaking copyright law, it tells them.
Everybody believes that they hide behind this great, huge World Wide Web and nobody knows who they are. Our software finds you. It finds your IP address and it allows us to know where you are. By knowing where you are, we can take you off the net.
That's the theory. But the internet pirates aren't ending up in court. Until now, the industry bosses wouldn't risk the bad PR of criminalizing their customers. Now, for the first time, they plan to prosecute.
It's one of the great ironies that our enemy in this is our consumer, and one of the rules that anybody in marketing knows is not make an enemy of your customer. We have no choice, because frankly, when the music is being consumed for free, they're no longer customers that we can look after, nor customers that we want.
Hollywood, California. The Hollywood studios, particularly Disney, don't want to suffer the same fate as the music industry. They worry that their business and jobs are at stake. They want their films protected against internet piracy. Films like Disney's latest feature, Lilo and Stitch, which was successfully released last month in the US and is coming to Britain in October.
His name is Stitch.
Oh, great! He's loose!
He's taken a police cruiser!
Yeah, he took the red one.
A feature animated film is a heavy investment. It could be anywhere from $50 to $150 million, depending on the amount of manpower and computer-generated imagery that might be required.
Hey, that's not Simba!
It's a very involved process. It's a very high-risk business. It's a heavy investment business. And that's why we're so keen to protect the fruits of our labor. Research in the United States, a company called Viant, based in Boston, already indicates that over 350,000 films are being illegally downloaded over the internet every single day. And that's in the United States alone. So you can do the math, but it's easy to see how billions of dollars can be lost and markets can be ruined.
But there are those in the film industry who don't share Hollywood's pessimism. Alex Cox is an independent film director who worked in Hollywood on his first film, Repo Man, and also made Sid and Nancy. His latest project is Revenge as Tragedy.
I don't think that the downloading issue from the internet is an issue at all. I think it's completely a bogus complaint, and it's analogous to the complaint that was made against the video cassette recorder 20 years ago, 30 years ago, when the industry did exactly the same crybaby act and said, you know, people recording films off television is going to put us out of business. Well, it didn't. It actually created another revenue stream, and they were able to sell video cassettes at the same time as people taped off air. And in the end, the studios were proved wrong in the courts, and the courts decided against them. But 30 years ago, the courts were much more pro-consumer. Now they're much more pro-corporate.
Alex Cox feels Hollywood is exaggerating the internet problem.
What harm does it do the studios, even if people are downloading DVD-quality movies off the internet? What harm does it do them? They're still selling DVDs, and the DVDs that they sell come complete with additional elements, little books, documentaries about the films. People who buy DVDs, they buy them because they want to keep them, because they like the package. Now, they've probably downloaded it off the internet as well. But that isn't going to stop going out and spending £20 to buy the DVD too, because you're talking about people who are really into movies. You know, these are film fans. These are not criminals.
Okay, ready, mate? Action!
These arguments don't impress Hollywood. They simply want to stop internet piracy. They're worried that current technologies to stop copying of DVDs and CDs have proved ineffective.
Well, at the moment, content comes through, sometimes free and clear without any form of protection at all, and sometimes with encryption of some sort. What usually happens is that the encryption is hacked. So it's proven so far to be insufficiently robust, and for that reason, we feel an additional layer of security is needed to create the sort of environment that we would need.
Disney are right to be worried. 3 months before the UK release of Lilo and Stitch, the British cyber pirate can already find sites offering the film for download.
If a new type of copy protection came out to prevent you sharing or copying files from DVD, that would stop you doing this, but only for a short time. Then a way would be found around that.
It's not enough. Hansen won the Carnegie Scholarship.
No, he has to have it all for himself.
Until he is ready.
Now Hollywood wants to change computers to protect its films. They want new technology to be put inside computers, which will mean that only bona fide films will play. The major studios have been lobbying very hard for a change to US law. In March, they went to the US Congress to put forward their proposals for changes in legislation.
What we're advocating is for a watermark technology to be embedded in the content that will identify the content as copyrighted. What we'd like to see happen is for hardware manufacturers to build devices that will recognize that watermark so that illegal content can no longer pass through to the consumers.
Hollywood's answer to the internet pirates is still under discussion in Congress, but it's causing anxiety in Silicon Valley. The computer industry doesn't want to change its products to suit Hollywood. Here at Intel, the largest microchip manufacturer in the world, they're very concerned that the Hollywood solution would harm computer sales and has Big Brother overtones.
I think our future is at stake. The future not only of Intel, but of the information technology industry. We know that if the government simply says, put a piece of protection technology everywhere in the web, we're going to end up in an environment where consumers are going to say, I don't want to buy that technology. It invades my privacy. It takes control out of my hands on my creative experience. And I don't think any consumer anywhere in the world views that as an acceptable environment.
If Intel or anyone else has a better solution than the one we're proposing, we're most open-minded to it. We're not trying to pick fights with anyone, but we feel, having looked at the situation and thought very hard about it, that this is the best solution that will produce the secure environment that we're looking to create.
The entertainment industry's been reluctant to sell on the internet until they're satisfied with the protection against copying. But whilst they're trying to make that happen, technology is making copying even easier. Superfast downloading is becoming widely available. It's called broadband. With broadband, films can be downloaded in a matter of hours, and it's getting faster all the time. Music can be copied in just a few seconds. 500,000 people in Britain already have it. And more get it every day. The cyber pirates think they're gaining the advantage over the industry.
I think they're missing a couple things. One, that this is an unstoppable force, and it is the future. I think they're also missing the fact that it's a great opportunity for them.
These super conglomerates and corporations have gotten so far from reflecting the people is when something comes up out of the society and out of the public that has its own dictation, they can't adapt.
The industry believes that the next few months will be crucial in their battle against the cyber pirates.
We're really at a crossroads, and what industry players and the government does next could very well determine whether the internet ultimately becomes a place for illegitimate commerce or a place for legitimate commerce.
But as millions continue to download for free, the dilemma for the entertainment industry is whether they can win the kind of protection they want without risking a consumer backlash that would harm them even further. Next week, No Accounting for Greed. America is awash with huge company frauds. Arthur Andersen were the auditors for most of them. The inside story of the accountants who've created a crisis in the world's financial system. A Money Program special next Tuesday at 10 to 10.